Where did you hear about it?
I've been here a couple times.
You've been here a bunch of times, okay. All right,
fine.
All right, well, thanks you all for coming. I really appreciate that. We only can fit 200 people in this room, so we've been kind of lax to advertise this, you know, whole hog and, you know, totally packed room and everything. We have also been, however, doing webcasting. We've been doing them for 10 years now. Actually, 9 years now, since 2005. So we get quite a number of people watching it online. And we usually get 500 to 1,000 people watch the archive webcast of this. So we can only fit 200 in the room. So actually, the online audience has been, for many years, the dominant audience. So that's what we're performing for. We're not, no. No, we actually love to have a wonderful studio audience, thank you, because it provides the live aspect of it. But we're finding that in the age of the internet, that the dominant audience will be our online and our recorded audience. But there's nothing like, of course, being here live and really hearing it from them and getting the energy that people produce. So thank you all for coming. I think I have vamped until it's now 8:01. Thomas, are we okay in the back room? All right, ladies and gentlemen, doing our webcasting, Mr. Thomas Marku. I don't know if Tony can hear me now, but Tony Darnell in the back room, he's probably sitting at home doing the YouTube broadcast. Give a hand for Tony Darnell.
We're clear? All right, let's get it started. Good evening and welcome to the Hubble Space Telescope Public Lecture Series. I'm your host, Dr. Frank Summers of the Office of Public Outreach here at the Space Telescope Science Institute. And it's my pleasure to see these wonderful smiling faces here tonight. And if you did not get one on the way in, we have pictures for you. And the picture this month is the planetary nebula NGC 2440, which provides a cool image on the front and a couple of cool facts on the back, as much as we can fit in, and I guess it's about 300 words for you. If you didn't get one on the way in, they should be over on the table on the way out. Our speaker tonight, also from the Office of Public Outreach, Bonnie Meinke, talking on Moonrise, the surprisingly diverse array of moons in our solar system. Actually, I heard her give this talk last week, and it's a fun talk. I know you're gonna enjoy it. Upcoming, we have a speaker, TBA, we've tried to book him before. He has come up many, many times, but he's never actually spoken here. All right, I hope this time that he also doesn't speak here, because I will fill that in before next month. Unfortunately, I won't be here next month. I will be in Boston, Massachusetts, for the American Astronomical Society conference. So I will have a guest host come in, and since you'll be there and Brandon will be there, maybe I'll get Ray to come in and guest host. In July, we have a wonderful talk, Building New Worlds in Protoplanetary Disks. I'm actually gonna talk about some disks in just a minute, so you'll get an understanding of that, Andrea Banzati. And on August 5th, a discussion of a amazingly ambitious project that is 3 years. It's one of the largest projects Hubble has ever worked on. It's called the Frontier Fields, a sneak peek at the first billion years of the universe. And this is the PI, Jennifer Lotz. She'll be talking about the first initial results, because of course this is a 3-year project. They'll only be about 6 to 7 months into it when she gives this talk. So she'll have some results, but there's gonna be a lot of cool stuff coming from that in the future. If you want to know about our talks, we have our Go link, hubblesite.org/go-talks, or if you go to your favorite search engine and type in Hubble Public Lecture, you should find this webpage. We have a list of the upcoming speakers, and we have a link to the archive. We've been webcasting since 2005. That's 9 years of cool astronomy talks for you to go back and watch. That'll take you a weekend or two to watch, so you can find them. And that link right here, the STScI Public Lecture Series on our webcasting site. In addition, as of last week, we started taking these and putting them out on YouTube on Hubble Site channel. So youtube.com/HubbleSiteChannel, an alternate way. So here is last week's speaker, Terra Sapiens, the Human Chapter in History of Earth. This is not David Grinspoon, that is me. The camera cut to his slides. I wanted a great shot because he had that cool little hat, right? He walked up here and immediately walked over there, and so the camera cut to his slides, and I didn't have a good shot of him standing here at the podium. So unfortunately, I had to use my ugly mug for this. But you can see that we've got all an hour and 37 minutes of it up there. And then, of course, while you're there, you can look at the other videos we have on Hubble Site Channel, our cool videos, some of my unfiltereds. We have some Hubble Hangouts, all sorts, a wide array of cool things to watch on YouTube. Email. We send out announcements. If you're on the email list, you got an announcement yesterday and today. Sign up by providing your email address. If you got a card, give it to me afterwards. If you want to write it down on a piece of paper, hand it to me at the end of the lecture, please do so. You won't get any spam, okay? Easy way to do it is you can send an email to publiclectured@stsci.edu, and you can send us comments or questions. If there's something that you didn't get to ask the speaker, send it in there. You can also sign up for announcements, because if you send email there, we'll have your email address and add you to our list. Social media, if you are into any of the social medias, we've got a good number of them covered. We're on Facebook, we've got two Twitter accounts, we're on Google Plus, and actually it was funky because one of the reasons we're doing YouTube is we have like 2 million followers on Google Plus. So that's quite an audience to feed with lots of cool stuff about astronomy. Pinterest, which I have no idea, I don't do. I do my podcast, I'm on Facebook, I'm on Google Plus, and I sometimes Twitter, which is rare for me. But hey, you gotta cover the social media these days. All right, after the lecture, Duncan, I don't know, are you here yet, Duncan? All right, Duncan said he would be here to take people across to the Maryland Space Grant Observatory. So if you would like to look at whatever is up in the sky tonight, I'm sure there'll be some interesting things. You can go to the Maryland Space Grant Observatory with Duncan Watts after the lecture, okay? We'll probably meet down here to my right. Okay. And now, my segment, the news from the universe for May 2014. Okay, first story. Can we take the lights down a little bit, Thomas? All right, there we go. All right, first story is called Five Golden Rings. Now, you may remember that we have discovered a lot of, we've done some discoveries by looking at stars and then blocking out their light. One of the most famous ones was the discovery of planets, and this is around the star HR 8799. And this is the light of the star that has been blocked, and here are the positions of three planets around HR 8799. Now, this is from the Keck telescope, right? And they discovered three planets around this star using the Keck telescope. What we did here at Hubble was we went back into the archival data that Hubble had, and an infrared image of HR 8799, and you can see how there's incredible amount of starlight. Well, we folks here worked on some amazing techniques for modeling the point spread function of stars, how that light spreads out into this diffraction spikes and all the stuff in here, such that we were able to subtract out the light of that star and find 1, 2, 3 planets. Right, in archival data. Once we knew they were there, we could apply this new computer technique for subtracting out the light of the star and gain a longer baseline. This added 10 years to the motion of those planets that we knew about because we could go into archival data. We're going to take that same idea and apply it to dust disks. And here are my two favorite dust disks that Hubble has observed. AU microscopy, where you can see the edge-onness of this disk. So it really is a thin, you know, frisbee-like or tortilla-like, pancake-like disk of material. And again, the light of the star has been blocked. And then HD 107146, where that disk is now, instead of seeing edge-on, is now being seen face-on. And you can see the nice circle of this dust disk. And these dust disks are really cool because this is where planets form around stars. Around in a forming star, you get this dust material, a disk of a material around it, and in these dust disks are where planets form. Now, these are two really beautiful images, but we want to then utilize the technique that we have from other things. So the example here is using star HD 181327, which the dust disk around it was known, and using a normal star removal, you can see how ugly this sucker is. Okay? I mean, there's just, you know, you can see there's a disk, but you can see the light of the star penetrates into it, and you get a lot of uncertainties about what you're doing. With this new technique, they're able to subtract out the star more cleanly and gain a better view of the stuff around it. All right? So we're able to utilize this new technique. And again, these disks are not new. We're not discovering them, but we're going back and being able to make better observations of them. And so here are two examples, all right, where you can see an edge-on disk, and you can see a slightly oblique disk here, and here are the artist diagrams to guide your eyes to what you're seeing up here. All right, by using this new point spread function subtraction technique, we're able to get more detail. And it's not just these two, but as I said in the title of this story, we had five golden rings that we announced in this press release. All right, so these are five different disks that we knew were there, but using this new point spread function technique, we're able to see them more clearly, get better observations, and more details and understanding of how these dust disks, the structure of these dust disks and how planets may form around newborn stars. Our second story, a tailspin breakup. Whole bunch of wordplay in that one thing. All right, so we have, you guys remember Comet Ison from last year, right? Okay. And this is an this is one of my favorite images of it from a UK photographer, Damien Peach, November 15th last year. Just an amazing shot of Comet Ison. But of course, we remember what happened to Comet Ison, that it came past the sun and it broke up. It disintegrated, went to pieces. All right, now, this happens for comets. We expect this, okay? And not just comets that pass by the sun. Here is the breakup of comet Schwachmann-Wachmann 3. I use this comet just because I like saying Schwachmann-Wachmann 3. and this is just the B fragment, okay? So you can see the pieces of it breaking off. All right, and this is just the B fragment as it broke up in April of 2006. So we expect comets, as they go past the sun, they lose material, their ices, they heat up, and they naturally will break apart. But what we didn't expect was to see this. This is the asteroid P2013R3, which was only discovered in September of last year, hence the designation 2013 and R3. And it was discovered as several fuzzy blobs, and it was seemed interesting enough to look with Hubble. So this was October 29th, and then on November 15th, and December 13th, and on to January 14th, we're seeing an asteroid break up. Now, asteroids are these big giant rocks, right? Ice balls, okay, we can understand how a snowball disintegrates and breaks up, but now we're seeing the breakup of a rock thing. And here is the four pictures together, and you can see this disintegration sequence. And this is not common, all right? I believe this is the first time we've truly seen a full breakup of this that we could not attribute to two of them smashing together. Okay, I've shown you stuff in the past where we believe that there are two asteroids that smash together and cause some breakup. But here's one where it's not due to, where we do not believe that it's due to a collision. So what's going on here? Well, you can see each of these pieces here is losing some material and is developing the tail. That's the tail in the title. But the spin in the title is due to one hypothesis of what could be doing this, is that this asteroid got a torque on it that caused it to rotate fast enough that the material broke apart. Okay? Now, you might think, wow, that would have to be an incredible amount, but we're not sure if these asteroids are singular rocks, or if they're what we call rubble piles, all right, held together by mutual gravity, but not a single piece of rock. All right, and this, we would assume, if it was a rubble, more of the rubble pile model of asteroids, and got to be spinning fast enough, then centrifugal force could pull it apart like this. Truth is, we don't truly know why it is broken up like this, but Dave Jewett and his team will be studying it continuously, trying to find out why and doing more observations to show you that, you know, it's not just comets that break up, but even asteroids can suffer what I just called a tailspin breakup. Our final story is a Hubble anniversary present for you, part two. Now, how many of you who were here last month? Okay, not enough, okay. The rest of you, you know, get up with it. All right, if you remember what I told you last month, and for those of you who weren't here, all right, in April 24th, 1990 was when the space shuttle launched carrying Hubble aboard. That was 24 years ago. All right, April 25th was the deployment of Hubble. And of course, we do something special for each year for Hubble's anniversary. This year, however, we had a conference in Rome on science with the Hubble Space Telescope, and we released the image that we always do a month early. And it was that image that I showed you last month very briefly with the teaser that, hey, I'll show you something even cooler next month. Okay, so what I didn't tell you last month was that this image comes from something called NGC 2174, or more poetically, it's called the Monkey Head Nebula. You all can squint and try and figure out how you see the monkey head. At first, I couldn't see it, and then I go, oh, yeah, I guess I could possibly see it. It's up to you, okay? Beauty is in the eye of the beholder on this one. But this is, what?
You don't have any pictures of this for us.
I don't have any pictures of the monkey head to give out to you, sorry. These lithographs do take a little time to create, so maybe we'll have the monkey head for you later. So you can see that this square here is where Hubble took an image, right? And the Hubble's 24th anniversary image was not in visible light as this is, but in infrared light. And so here was the 24th anniversary image that we released. All right, this half of the audience go ooh. This half of the audience go ah. Thank you. All right. We've got oohs and ahs. All right, this is the infrared view of the pillars in the Monkey Head Nebula. Really cool. All right. Well, however, you've seen this, if you pay really close attention to everything Hubble releases, you would know that we've released this before right here, but only as a visible light image. So years ago, we released, in 2001, we took the image in visible light, and here is the contrasting image in infrared, which provided us with a cool opportunity so that we could do a visualization of this. Our team in the Office of Public Outreach loves to do cool visualizations, so what we're going to do is we're going to zoom into it in visible light, transfer to infrared light, and then pull out of a 3D model for you. All right, and this is something that we added for Hubble's 24th anniversary. On the anniversary date, we added to the press release that we did the month earlier this visualization. So we start at Gemini and Orion, and you find that the monkey head is right in between them. Technically, it's in the constellation of Orion. And here's the DSS image of the monkey head. Come into that pillar, and we'll fade into Hubble's visible light image of it. Now let's crossfade to the 3D model in infrared and begin a slow pullback. Now, isn't that a beautiful nebula? Yeah. All right, someday in the future, I will have that as a lithograph for you, okay? Promise you. But for now, I have to move to our featured speaker. And our speaker tonight is Dr. Bonnie Meinke from the Office of Public Outreach in the Space Telescope Science Institute. And she made a huge mistake because she put in her biography that she's from Texas, along with that the stars at night are big and bright. All right, let's do a sing-along here, hold on. All right, so the stars at night are big and bright. All right, there we go. See, she almost dared me to bring that up as part of her introduction.
I have no shame.
That's why we're in public outreach, we have no shame. So after being inspired by those big and bright stars in Texas, she did her undergraduate degree in astronomy at the University of California, Berkeley. She was there just after I did my PhD there, so we didn't cross paths. She finished there and then went on to do her PhD at the University of Colorado, or is it Boulder? At Boulder, yes. And she has an expert on all things Saturn, in my opinion. She's my go-to person when I need to know something about Saturn. And if you were here a year ago, you heard her talk about Saturn's mysterious F-ring. Well, Saturn also has some really cool moons, and being a planetary astronomer, she knows all sorts of things about cool moons. So tonight, she'll be talking to you about Moonrise, the surprisingly diverse array of moons in our solar system. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Bonnie Meinke.
Well, now I feel bad, because no matter what I talk about, that last part's all you guys are going to remember from tonight. But that's okay. I'm going to try to make you guys go home with other points to remember besides just that the stars at night are big and bright in Texas. So, I'm talking about moons in the solar system. I'm going to start in the inner solar system. And some of you might be familiar with the inner system. We live in the inner part of the solar system. And we have four rocky planets that comprise the inner solar system. We have Mercury with zero moons. We have Venus with zero moons. We have Earth with one moon that we're all very familiar with, I'm sure. And we have Mars with two moons, but those two moons are little piddling nothings. They're basically captured asteroids. They're not that exciting. In fact, they're pretty tiny, and so much so that I really had to blow these two pictures up of Phobos and Deimos so you guys could see them. So this is interesting. The Earth is the only one of these four with a moon. And not only that, it's a pretty big, substantial moon compared to the size of the Earth. So I want to talk in the first part of this, our time tonight, about Earth's moon. It's our celestial partner, and I want to frame this with some questions. Why is the Earth the only rocky planet with a substantial moon? How does this benefit the Earth? And more specifically, how does this make it suited for life? How does this benefit life on Earth? Okay? So let's start with how the moon was formed. So, because that's a big part of the puzzle. These other planets in the inner solar system don't have moons. And the way that we got our moon was a mystery for a long time, up until maybe the last few decades. And even within the last few decades, scientists were debating how this truly happened. The Apollo missions kind of helped us get some ground truth, and from there we were able, the rise of supercomputing really helped too, because it takes a lot to do different simulations of how the moon could have formed. So it takes major computing power, so that really helped too. But we've come to a scientific consensus that it's something called giant impact. What happened was there was a proto-Earth where we are now, and there was an object about the size of Mars that was within our orbital space, impacted the proto-Earth, dug out a whole lot of the material that was the then crust and upper mantle of the proto-Earth, shredded that Mars-sized object, and ended up creating a disk. So for a short period of time, the Earth had rings. okay? One big, rocky, lumpy, lava-like ring that eventually coalesced over a fairly short time scale. We're talking months and years here, okay? Coalesced again to become what is now our moon. And so this happened, a long time ago. We can basically call it the beginning of our solar system. But, it's an interesting thing that happened and resulted in something that is kind of peculiar in our solar system, which is a large moon around a rocky planet. So in this whole formation mechanism, I mentioned that the proto-moon was smeared out into kind of a ring that then coalesced. And it coalesced pretty close in to the new Earth, okay? That new Earth is spinning really fast, which is why I have this arrow here that's really long. It's whipping around. It's going really fast, really short days on this Earth, okay, with the moon very close in. But then over time, thanks to tides, the Earth's spin slows down a little bit, and the moon recedes. The moon gets farther and farther away from the Earth. Eventually, the Earth slows down even more, and the moon is even farther away to where we see it today. During this process, the moon itself also has a spin. Okay, so in the moon first form, it was turning around pretty fast as well. And again, that's why I have the big arrow here. And over time, as the moon receded, it spun more and more slowly. And eventually, it becomes tidally locked, which is why I have two halves of this moon in this little cartoon here. Eventually, only one side of the moon faces the Earth. This means that the lunar month, is also the lunar day. Okay? It takes that much time to rotate on its axis. Like I said, this is a process called tidal locking. And this is why we only see one face of the moon, and this is why the moon seems so familiar and unchanging and constant to us, is because it is tidally locked. And this is a process that happens with a lot of two-body systems. So most of the moons I'll talk about in the second half of my talk are tidally locked as well. We're also finding exoplanets close in to their stars that are tidally locked. So one side of that hot Jupiter faces the sun at any time, and it gets even hotter. That's a whole separate talk. But this is what tidal locking is. It's a common thing. And we have a beautiful example every time we look up in our skies, or most of the time when we look up in our skies, because the moon's not out all the time. But so just give you an idea, this will continue to happen. The moon continues to recede from the Earth at about 4 centimeters per year. So very slowly. You don't have to worry about it zipping off anytime soon. The Earth's day, the Earth's rotation period, slows down even more. So that eventually, the Earth itself will become tidally locked to the moon. So only one side of the Earth will face the moon at any one time. And people on the other side of the Earth will not be able to see the moon. This you do not have to worry about, because as Frank mentioned earlier, I knew this was a very smart audience. I went ahead and did the math earlier today, and it will take 200 billion years for this to happen. Not only will we not be here, the Earth probably won't be here, the sun probably won't be here. So, the remnants, some sort of remnants maybe, but not in its current state, so don't worry about it. Don't lose any sleep over it tonight. But, this does happen in other systems on different timescales. All right. So now that I've prefaced how the dynamics of the system, I want to talk a little bit about how having a partner like the moon really benefits Earth. And it all comes back to these dynamics, this kind of orbital dance that we do together. It makes us really good partners. And I have two aspects to this. I have the environmental stability aspect, which I'm going to really talk about a lot. I also wanted to include something that I thought was kind of fun, which is development of human civilization. And you know, that's another talk for another night. But it's something that's also important that we need to keep in mind when we think about the moon. But let's dive into environmental stability. Having the moon allows for tides, which means circulation of our oceans. It means having a meteor shield. If you look at the far side of the moon here, it's got a lot of craters on it, and those are things that didn't hit Earth. So the moon takes a lot of hits for the Earth, and we thank it for that. And finally, the tilt of the Earth's axis, the reason we have seasons, and that is stable because of the moon, okay? So, like I said, the moon gives us tides. We are fortunate enough to have liquid oceans, and those liquid oceans are easily deformable by gravity. So as the moon goes around the Earth, it tugs on the Earth, and the thing that most easily gives is liquid water. So we have tides. That moon goes toward, kind of follows where the wherever the moon is, and that means that on our shores it comes in and it goes out. This circulates ocean water, which is great. It means that there's regular movement of stuff. Unless you think about the Pacific trash gyre thing, which is terribly depressing, but everywhere else it's circulating, which is good. It also means that in these areas where it's coming in and out, there's a salinity gradient. We have estuaries where life can form, develop, flourish, and it gives us things like tidal pools. Again, a way that life can help develop life. Water coming in and out of an area means that things get oxygen. Water brings in nutrients to those areas, gives water fauna a chance to hold on and start going to land. So there's a whole bunch of things that the tides do for us in terms of helping life develop and hold on. All right. The moon also acts as a meteor shield, as I said. And it has some cons in this way, too. It increases the overall mass of the Earth-Moon system, which you could argue brings in a couple extra meteors. But overall, what it does is it grabs a couple of those meteors for us and takes the hits so that those objects don't come in closer to the Earth and possibly strike the Earth. And one of the best ways to see this is by looking at the far side of the moon. Here, right here, and you can see newer craters are brighter. That's one of the ways you can tell how recent something is, and I'm speaking geologically here, so we're still talking millions of years in some cases, but you can see there's some more spots of bright material on the far side of the moon. So every one of those little things is something that didn't hit us. And the other factor of environmental stability that the moon gives us has to do with the tilt of the Earth's axis. Now, the tilt, every object in the solar system has a tilt. I might use the word obliquity, too. This is just how much of a tilt, the angle that the rotational axis of the body is away from the orbital plane of the solar system, okay? So in this case, Earth is tilted 23 degrees with respect to to its orbital plane, okay? But you see here two extreme examples. We have Uranus in our system that is basically on its side. As you can see here, it's tilted by 97 degrees. So that's We're not really sure what happened there, but that's something for again, another talk. And then there's Venus, which almost appears to rotate backwards with respect to the other planets. But you could also look at that system as having an axial tilt of 177 degrees, so being completely upside down. Okay. But we have another planet in our solar system that's very, very similar to Earth in terms of its axis tilt, and that is Mars. Mars is currently at 25 degrees obliquity. So, you know, we like Mars. NASA likes Mars. We keep going to Mars. We keep looking for life on Mars, looking for the possibility of liquid water having been on Mars. So part of that is, you know, these similarities between Earth and Mars. But don't take everything at its face value. This is actually kind of an interesting story. Mars hasn't always been at 25 degrees in axis tilt. In fact, it's possible that its tilt swung to as much as 60 degrees in sometimes in its history. And this doesn't even happen over short time period, over long time periods. This is over short time periods, something like 100,000 years. Which geologically speaking is the blink of an eye. So this means when you have something with a high axial tilt, like I have here on the left, you can see that where the solar rays come in, these yellow arrows I have here, more direct solar radiation is hitting the poles on the summer side, in the summer hemisphere, okay? In this case, the northern hemisphere. This means that it can completely melt whatever polar ice cap there may be, which means that the overall atmosphere is full of if it's water, it's more humid, which means that sea levels rise. It also means that there is a larger deposition on the winter side, winter hemisphere, in this case, the southern hemisphere. So which is why this is white, because I'm saying this is the polar ice cap, because it goes to lower latitudes. Basically, the mid-latitudes end up with lots of ice. This means different land features, geologic features, different sorts of historical sea lines, shorelines, excuse me. And so this is how we know that Mars went through obliquity swings up to 60 degrees. Okay, bigger tilts, hotter summers, colder winters, big shifts in the ice caps. Over here I have, on the right-hand side, I have a planet that doesn't have much of an axis tilt. And you can see that overall it's going to have smaller ice caps, but those ice caps will probably stay in place from one season to the next. There won't be as much material that goes into the atmosphere. It won't be as humid during the summers. And this means overall less seasonal variation. So I'm not saying, I want to make one thing clear. I'm not saying that one of these is preferable for life over the other, but what I am saying is that these produce two drastically different climates. And if you swing from one to the other really quickly, geologically quickly, you throw everything out of whack. If you don't have a stable climate, it makes it harder for life to take hold. Okay? So we have, and just for those of you in the audience interested, this is called the Milankovitch cycle. Okay? So we have this comparison of two seemingly similar planets in terms of obliquity, but really the Earth has a long-term stability of tens of millions of years against big obliquity shifts. In the span of about 100,000 years, we can change by up to 4 degrees, but 4 degrees isn't a whole lot, okay? And this is tens of millions of years. It probably took life on this planet, a few billion years to first appear. And that means that it needed some stability. It needed a quiet, nice, resting place to call home before it could really start to thrive. So our moon keeps this axis tilt in place. It makes sure that it stays around 23 degrees at all times, just gravitationally. Whereas Mars has no partner, has no large satellite partner to keep it at 25 degrees. So it's moving all over the place on timescales of hundreds of thousands of years. So that makes it a lot harder for a constant, stable climate that life might be happy with. Okay, so that's all about environmental stability. I want to take you guys through human civilization now, just real quickly, and point out some of the great things that for advanced life, as we like to think of ourselves, how it has really benefited the development of human civilization. One of the great ways is with calendars. Lunar calendars were some of the first types of calendars in the ancient world. They helped our ancestors build agrarian civilizations because you have to know when to plant and when to harvest and those sorts of things. So calendars are great for that. And you know, even in more modern times, it's an exploration stepping stone. The moon is right there. It's slightly outside of our gravity well. So in terms of, like, we have to launch a rocket there, but we only have to get to the moon. It's a very short distance in terms of time and supplies that you need to take with you to support human life. Whereas, you know, if we were going to go to, it could be a stepping stone. So if we wanted to go to an asteroid or to an outer solar system moon, those take much longer times, you know, months and years. And this gives us some testing ground for the technologies and for the ability to expand our reach out into the solar system and eventually the galaxy. So the moon is great for civilization as well. So I just kind of wanted to sum up all of the points I made here, but give you guys this feeling, this takeaway message, that the moon really provides us with a stable environment. This stable environment is conducive to the development of life, especially long-term survivability of life, whether it be microbes, humans, plants, everything in between. It helps give us that stability that life needs in many aspects. Okay, so that's our moon. Now I want to take you guys across the outer solar system and frame this in the context of, is there other stuff out there that also offers a stable environment? So that's the question to keep in mind for this next part of the talk. So we discussed the inner solar system and how special Earth is with our large moon and how dinky Phobos and Deimos are, and nobody cares about them. But now we go out to the outer solar system. And as Frank mentioned earlier, this is where my bread and butter is. I love the outer solar system. Saturn's so pretty. and so interesting. Each one of these has a whole lot of interesting stuff about it as a planet itself. But I'm not going to talk about the planets at all. I'm going to talk about the moons that they have. And you can see from these large numbers that I put up over each one of these planets, that's the number of moons that each one of them has. And I put the little the greater than sign there because there's a lot of moons out there. We don't know about all of them, especially for Uranus and Neptune here. All right, we've pretty extensively surveyed the Saturn system. And we know that there are at least 62 moons in that system. I say at least because we've discovered a whole lot in the last 10 years with the Cassini mission. And we see moons forming with the Cassini mission. So there's constant recycling of ring material, and moons are forming, moons are colliding and disintegrating. So this isn't a constant number. For these sorts of systems, it's constantly evolving. Jupiter does, I mean, they all have ring systems. So ring systems really promote this sort of recycling as well. In fact, at Uranus, there's what people have described as a conveyor belt of moonlets coming out, just constantly being churned out, time scales of like a year. So it's an interesting thing. And we need to explore more. That's my push, everybody. Go tell your congressman. We need to explore more in the outer solar system. So we can nail down these numbers, right? That's important. Okay. Well, I'm going to take, so these are very large numbers. I don't want us to be here until, you know, 2 a.m. while I go through a survey of each and every one. So I'm going to give you guys some of the highlights tonight. But I wanted to show you guys some of how big this list is, and give you an idea of size and scale. So I have Earth on here for a scale bar, and you can see how big some of these moons are. So here's our moon. The moons around Jupiter, some of them are quite large. In fact, Ganymede is the largest moon in the solar system. And Saturn also has the very large moon Titan, and a bunch of medium-sized moons, I'll call them. Uranus, these are the medium-sized moons that we can see. There's a whole lot of other ones that, as I said, are being made like on a conveyor belt. And Neptune, pretty far out. We've only really seen it with Voyager. We do know that it has some pretty cool moons, including Triton, which I'll talk about in a bit. And just for some scale, Pluto and Eris out here have these other, they're not really even moons, they're dual objects. So they mutually rotate around each other. Okay, I wanted to give you some comparison to other planets, though. So one of the things I mentioned, Ganymede is the biggest moon in our solar system. Ganymede is bigger than some planets. Even Titan is bigger than Mercury. Ganymede's just slightly smaller than Mars. Then we have, you know, Callisto's almost comparable to Mercury. And all of these are bigger than Pluto. So there's a long list of moons that are bigger than Pluto. I'm not showing my biases there, am I? Okay. Oh, wait. I didn't even point out these guys. These are the medium-sized moons I was talking about. And they are all interesting and special in their own way. Basically, moons are like snowflakes. Okay? So, let's go through this real quick. I mentioned the stability that our moon provides us. And so we have that framework in mind tonight, that it provides a circulation of water with the tides. It's a shield from impacts. And it's also something that provides a stable climate and environment on Earth. But what the Earth already has by itself without a moon is it has a shield from radiation and from impacts, which is the atmosphere and the magnetosphere. I will talk a little bit about those. It has its own water, specifically liquid water, which we all benefit from, and reminds me that I probably should take a drink, and it has energy, both from the sun, which every plant benefits from. Photosynthesis is a wonderful thing, and I'm sure many of you were very happy to see the sun today. But we also have our own internal heat. The Earth is very large. We have a mantle underneath the crust, and a part of the core is liquid as well. Those things are all sources of energy. There's radioactive elements. There's the heat of everything having formed and accreted in the initial formation of the Earth. So there's lots of energy in our system, and those water and energy are especially important for life. Okay, so we need to frame this in the context of, in the outer solar system, do we need to rethink these factors of stability? Are there ways to get things other than the Earth model that make an environment stable? Okay, So let's start with Titan. I'm sure many of you have heard of Titan. It's a very sexy object because it's the most Earth-like of the moons that we've discovered so far. Heck, it's the most Earth-like of any of the objects we found in our solar system. So a big part of this is what you see in the picture. It has this big, hazy atmosphere. And the atmosphere is similar in thickness to Earth's. This atmosphere actually provides rain. Like we have the water cycle here on Earth, on Titan, they have the methane cycle. So it rains liquid methane. There are lakes of liquid methane. And it's possible, there's rivers, it's all liquid methane. It's like bizarro Earth, basically, in that way. This thick, hazy atmosphere also protects from impacts the same way that our atmosphere burns up smaller meteors as they come through our atmosphere. It also protects against certain types of radiation, the same way our atmosphere does. For example, our atmosphere blocks a lot of UV radiation. It also protects us from much higher energy cosmic rays and things like that. So it's our atmosphere provides a certain amount of protection, same as Titan. And as I mentioned before, an atmosphere stabilizes climate. So Titan is very attractive to the planetary scientist, especially to the comparative planetologist interested in astrobiology. But I think it's too cold. Many people think it's too cold, and that this methane cycle may not be ideal. You do need some part of that to be water. Hydrocarbons like methane are great, but you want something else. So let's move on, okay? Let's move on to magnetic field. I used the word magnetosphere before. The magnetosphere is a nice little bubble or cocoon that surrounds a planet that has a magnetic field. Basically redirects a lot of the sun's radiation, away from that planet or body and keeps it nice and stable. In this case, I chose to show you guys Ganymede. Ganymede has an intrinsic magnetic field, the same way Earth does, which means that it's its own magnet, all right? This protects it against the harsh radiation environment of Jupiter, because Jupiter has all kinds of radiation coming off of it. But Ganymede's not the only other moon out there with a magnetosphere. There are lots of moons with induced magnetic fields. Ganymede just happens to be the only one with an intrinsic magnetic field. These other ones are induced by the magnetic field of their host planet and by their internal structure, usually liquid elements, solid elements, liquid elements, solid elements. That's how induced fields work. So the other big moons around Jupiter all have induced magnetic fields. So that's Europa, Io, Callisto. And I'll take you guys through those in a minute. But you can see that Ganymede, even though it's really big and it has an intrinsic magnetic field, it kind of looks like our moon on the outside. You don't see any cities popping up there anytime soon. It doesn't look like too exciting for life, per se. So we went through atmospheres and we went through magnetic fields, but what else could a shield take? Because I mentioned, that the Earth by itself, and especially with the moon, there's a shielding aspect that creates a stable environment on a body. And besides a magnetic field or an atmosphere or a moon to do some of the physical blocking, what else could there be? Well, the answer in the outer solar system is an ice shell. And there are multiple moons that are icy moons out there, especially that we know of around Jupiter and Saturn. And these can protect us against impacts, radiation, and heat loss. So they keep the heat in the same way that our atmosphere on Earth keeps that heat inside so that we all stay nice and toasty, possibly dangerously so if you get into a situation like Venus. We need something for all of those aspects. And what we have are some examples here. We have Europa around Jupiter. We have Enceladus around Saturn. And those are the two examples I want to use for this today. I've shown this kind of artist's depiction of what the inside of Enceladus probably looks like. And you can see this ice shell, a thick ice shell that protects whatever's inside of it. Okay. Well, speaking of heat and making sure that the heat stays in, we need to make sure that these moons have internal heat. I mentioned energy before. When you're out in the outer solar system, you're not getting a lot of light from the sun. So you're going to need your own, you need to have your own battery pack, so to speak. And in this case, a lot of it comes from tidal interactions with their host planets. All right? You get a big gas planet, gas giant planet, kind of like Jupiter or Saturn, and a smaller rocky or icy moon around it. As that moon whips around, it's going to have a little gravitational dance with that planet, and something has to budge. On Earth, our tides cause the water, the liquid water oceans, to move. But if you have an ice shell or any other sort of shell, you're going to get squeezed. And it's like a water balloon where you have a rigid outer crust, but that it can flex, and inside all that liquid is sloshing around. That adds internal heat to the system. So this is called tidal heating. This happens to Io around Jupiter, to Europa around Jupiter, to Enceladus around Saturn, and to Triton around Neptune. I told you I'd come back to Triton. Okay, so the way that we tell that these moons have this internal heat is that we see geologic activity. And it blows my mind when I think about geologic activity on other bodies in the solar system. It's really cool to imagine volcanoes or geysers or any of those things that we take for granted on Earth on a different planet. So when I'm at Yellowstone, I really like to think that I'm on another planet. You're not far off if you think that. So Io is super cool because it has volcanoes. Every single one of these little pockmarks that you see is a volcano, and most of them are currently active. Io is the only body we know of in the solar system without a crater. The reason for that is because it resurfaces so quickly that there is all of those craters, impact craters, are painted over very quickly. All right, we can take different images of Io on a time scale of a few months, and we see the surface change. We see, you know, this red spot get bigger and bigger and bigger as more lava comes out of that volcano. The reason it's mostly yellow is brimstone. There's lots of sulfur and other noxious, nasty stuff coming out of these volcanoes. It's not a place you want to be, but it is kind of cool. Okay, the other three of these on here are icy moons. So they have geysers. Enceladus and Europa both have evidence of geysers erupting from their surfaces. Hubble recently found some evidence of this on Europa, and the Cassini mission discovered geysers and has photographed geysers coming out of the surface of Enceladus. We like to call it cold faithful. and Triton here, Triton, you can see on, it looks like it has two halves. The northern half looks like a cantaloupe, and the southern hemisphere is kind of hummocky and weird, and with these black spots. Well, those black spots are basically ice volcanoes, cryovolcanism you might have heard of, and the reason they're black is because those ices include a lot of nitrogen, which makes them dark. Okay, so all of these bodies, we see them evolving. We know that they have internal heat as a result. Okay, so I've taken everything I've just talked about and tried to put it into a table. I don't expect you all to read the whole table right now, but I put all of the moons on the top and a couple planets on the bottom, one that you might be familiar with. Earth checks every box. Earth has internal heat. Earth has a radiation shield. Earth has water. And in terms of geologic activity, Earth has everything. You know, we have geysers, we have volcanoes, we have plate tectonics, you know, earthquakes, things like that. I also put Mars, just because we do a lot of comparisons to Mars. Mars doesn't have a lot of internal heat left. It once had volcanoes, but not anymore, not for a long time since. It has a very, very thin atmosphere and very little water. And what it does have is underground and probably icy. So, but all these other moons that I just took you through check off a lot of boxes in some way, or whether it be, you know, a radiation shield. They may have ice, they may have an atmosphere, they may have a magnetosphere, but they have some combination of everything I just discussed. But you can see those top three are the ones I really want to pick out. That's Enceladus, Titan, and Europa. And they check every box. Or probably check every box, because Europa, I think we still need to really confirm the geysers, but we have evidence that they're there. Oops. And I'm going to eliminate Titan off the bat. Just bring it down. We only have, we're running out of time here in this talk, so I'm just going to eliminate it. It's too cold. Okay. So let's move on with Enceladus and Europa. Those two moons are the perfect combination. It's like when they were handing out names, they knew moons that would start with an E would be the interesting moons. So we have a protection from radiation in that ice shell. We have a protection from impacts with those ice shells. As you can see in this blown up shot, it's much prettier. You can see that they're underneath that ice shell, because it's protecting whatever underneath, there's a stable climate down there, okay? And inside, because of that tidal heating, it would be warm enough to support life, all right? If it's warm enough, it could be warm enough for liquid water down there. So I want to give you guys a little cutaways to show you how this could be ideal, okay? So this is Europa. Or an artist's depiction of Europa. We weren't actually able to slice out this quadrant. You can see that there's a relatively thin ice shell. If you looked at it here, it's probably tens of kilometers thick, which is relatively thin. And underneath, there would be a global ocean. Well, we've known this since the Galileo spacecraft was there. It took gravitational measurements. The way that the spacecraft orbits by Europa was able to give it a little tug and tell it what the inside makeup of that moon should look like. So we were able to predict from gravitational measurements that Europa has a global ocean underneath. Okay? And then recently, with Hubble, we found this. Now, this is just data mapped onto a image of Europa. But what we're seeing here is this data tells us that there's some sort of water vapor in this area. And the shape of it, the morphology, as we like to call it, of it, means that there's probably a plume, a geyser, something that's venting from the southern pole of Europa into space. The same way you see in this artist's depiction here. Another cold faithful. So put that on your summer road trip list. Okay. Now, thinking back to Enceladus, Enceladus, we started by seeing the geysers. All right. This is an actual image from Cassini. All right. This is one that was taken a little bit later. This isn't the discovery image, but with the discovery image, we actually thought there was something wrong with the camera. We were not expecting that at all. That's been one of the biggest surprises of the Cassini mission, has been the plumes of Enceladus. While every other instrument on board that maybe didn't take the pretty pictures but could confirm these plumes in some other way went back and measured and looked, and we were able to look at it so detailed that we were able to guess where geysers were coming from to make up this overall plume. And then we went back on multiple orbits to Enceladus with Cassini mission on flybys, and we're able to see those individual geysers and cross-check our measurements and our calculations and say, oh yeah, there is a geyser there. I knew it. Yes. Exactly. Yeah, wow is the right response. So first we found the geysers, and then Cassini had to do a couple more laps around Saturn and swing by Enceladus a few more times to be able to get that gravitational data, that little tug that lets us know that what the internal structure of Enceladus probably is. Oops. And what it is not a global ocean like on Europa, but some sort of localized southern hemisphere ocean or lake. But again, enough water there, significant amount of water, that will vent out through cracks that we call tiger stripes, vent out to space as geysers. Okay. So I've mentioned these two oceans. These are very exciting oceans. One of the things we know about the oceans on the Earth is that they're full of life. It's very exciting to think about a stable environment protected by these ice shells where there could be life, because there's liquid water and it's warm. All right? So I want to give you guys this reminder, the takeaway message of tonight, which is that moons give us stable places to live, whether it's Earth's moon, which helps maintain a life-friendly and stable environment, or the outer solar system moons, which, as I just showed you guys, create little pockets of habitability, little pockets where life can take hold and thrive underneath ice in oceans of water. So the thing to take away and to think about as we continue our search for life elsewhere is, when we're looking at exoplanets and we're looking for the other Earth, another Earth, do we want to include in that definition another moon? Or is just a planet enough? Do we need a planet and a sizable moon with it? And why even go that far? When we're really thinking about it, should we be more concerned with exploring our own backyard and going to Europa? So thank you for your attention today. And I'll be happy to take any questions too. I'm sorry, I've run over by about 8 minutes.
No.
I blame him. He talked early.
No. I talk on. You know, we staff to stop at 9:30. Okay, that's my only rule, is that 9:30 is the stopping point. And I just want to let you know, there's been a relatively good conversation on YouTube of comments on this.
Okay.
Unfortunately, my phone didn't let me refresh the comments as much as possible.
Hopefully all positive stuff. Hi, YouTube. I love you.
All right, down here.
I do refer to the mode of protecting the Earth many, many times. But if we look at the surface of the sphere, which would be made by where the moon is, the moon represents almost an infinitesimal spot. Is that a significant? How does that make significant protection?
Let's just repeat that for the folks on the webcast. So the question was, the moon has been, she referred to the moon as protecting the Earth. But if you took the geometric projection of the moon onto Earth's surface, such as a solar eclipse, a lunar eclipse does, or solar eclipse actually does, that would be a small spot on Earth. So how does it really protect that much?
You're very right about that. I'm not saying that it protects from all possible impacts, but it's a fraction of some of the things that could possibly hit us. And when you measure out having a moon versus having no moon, it provides some protection.
But doesn't it also deflect things that might be missing Earth and deflect them into Earth?
Exactly, but I was just going to add to that, is that because it's out there doing it in orbit around there, things that might hit us can be just slightly deflected off of their of an intersection path. The far side of the moon being so heavily cratered shows that it has certainly intercepted a good number of objects.
Yes, that's true.
All right, in the back over there.
It seems that none of the moons of the solar system has its own moon. Is such a situation too unstable?
Okay, got to repeat it.
Yeah.
Do any of the moons of our solar system have their own moon?
None of the moons of our solar system have their own moon that we've discovered so far. It would be possible to have a moon of a moon for a very short amount of time, but it would be dynamically unstable. So I can imagine a scenario where a moon gets hit, or two moons hit each other and create some rubble, some pieces, kind of like that asteroid you showed earlier, in which case something would start to orbit a moon, but eventually it would either collide with that moon or be stripped apart by the gravitational interactions of the whole system. So orbital dynamics in these situations account for a lot, both in the Moon-Earth system and then beyond. In when you have a giant planet, it's especially a factor.
And just to comment that we do know of asteroids that have moons, Ida and Dactyl being the most prominent example that we know of.
Yes.
So even small things.
Oh, I have one more thing to add to that, though.
Oh, go ahead.
As a rings person, there was some evidence at one point that one of the moons of Saturn had rings. We followed up with that, and we don't think that to be the case, but this got some different modeling going, some scientific modeling, and it's a possibility. Again, they would be short-lived. We're talking timescales of maybe 10 years to maybe 1,000 years, if that, probably less. It's probably not common. We'd be very special and lucky to see such an event, but it's possible.
Okay, over here.
What are the next steps if we want to explore Europa?
What are the next steps if we want to explore Europa? One of them is production of plutonium-238. We have to have...
Not the answer you were expecting, was it?
We have to have radio isotopes to be able to power a spacecraft to the outer solar system. Our last batch was on the Mars Science Lab Curiosity. So once we're going out, we need more. Solar panels are getting better, but you're way far away from the sun. You need a lot of energy. You need that. We were getting ours from originally... DOD was making it. No, DOE was making it. Then we were buying it from Russians, and now we are back to having a line item in the budget for production within NASA. But that needs to happen. And it's needed to happen for about a decade. That's why we're running so short. And that's why we to do another outer solar system mission. This is ideas. All these people have ideas. A Europa mission has been in the works for a few decades. Since Galileo spacecraft was in orbit around Jupiter, people saw that and said, I want to go back to there. And so it's been in the works for a long time. There's an idea of having some sort of something that would land on the surface, a lander, that would then drill down. And possibly, because it's possible that there are lakes, like you can see here. So within the crust, there could be lakes. Or if we were lucky, we could find a thin spot, be able to drill down to the ocean. All of that takes a lot of technology testing and a lot of money. A lot of ideas are out there. A lot of people have been working on these problems for a long time. But it's really about having the funding to be able to put ideas into action.
Okay, the gentleman who's new tonight.
Yes. I'd like to ask about tides. Certainly the atmosphere would have tides as well as the water. Would that have any effect on the Earth?
So our Earth.
The question repeated, please.
Yeah. Okay. do tides have an effect on the atmosphere, especially at Earth? The Earth's atmosphere is not appreciably affected by tides because we have so many other effects on the atmosphere that supersede it. So we have, we have our rotation, we have winds, and our atmosphere isn't that thick. So it's not, for example, it's not as thick as Venus's. So there's several factors there as to why the tides aren't the dominant force on our atmosphere.
Okay, over there.
On the subject of energy, has anybody speculated if there was life on Europa or Enceladus, what it would eat? Because it's not going to be photosynthetic, and it doesn't look like there's enough plate tectonic potential for it to be chemosynthetic. So what would the energy source be for life on a moon?
So the question is, what would the energy source for life on a moon be? Actually, I believe it would be chemotrophic because we see these vents at the bottom of our oceans. There's that one picture you just pointed at. So these sorts of things, these deep sea vents, the organisms that form around those start out as chemotrophic and then progress to other forms of energy. But those, there is enough energy and the right geology, maybe not plate tectonics, but there could be plumes in mantle coming up through whatever rocky core situation they have going on in these moons. Because all of these icy moons do have a core and some sort of rocky mantle around them. So that would be enough that you could get these sorts of deep sea vents.
Okay, down here.
How does global warming fall into all this? You say the moon keeps us stable. Global warming is hurting us. What's the correlation here?
So what's the correlation between global warming and the moon providing any protection to us?
Well, the stability of our atmosphere. I mean, we're getting all these terrible storms and all, and they're saying it's global warming. Is that true or false?
Okay, so there's I like the term climate change more than global warming, but yeah, because things change. It's not like a overall hot box, like things change in different spots. Climates change, and in this particular case, the moon doesn't have anything to do with that, and the moon really can't provide us any protection against global climate change. It's all about the atmosphere constituents.
The ozone layer, is that real or that?
Yes, the hole in the ozone layer has been measured.
How's that affecting us?
Well, it was in the southern hemisphere, close to the southern pole, and it's one of those things that it lets in. So ozone protects us from certain types of radiation, and if you have a hole in an ozone layer, some of that bad radiation gets in.
Right. I will note that David Grinspoon talked about that last week, so you can. His talk is archived on our webcast and also available on YouTube, so you can see him discuss it a little bit more detail.
Yeah, that's a good. David can talk about that a lot better than I can.
All right,
I think.
In the yellow.
Yeah, more basic question, going way back to the formation of the moon. What object, what kind of an object, hit the proto-Earth?
So the question is, what type of object hit the proto-Earth to form the moon?
Probably something about the size of Mars. There would, at this point, in that part of the formation of our solar system, there were things called planetesimals, which are objects that are bigger than a few kilometers up until mini planet sized. And so there's the possibility that there were other planets and planetesimals at that time that were occupying similar spaces, orbital spaces around the sun, You also have large, the giant planets like Jupiter forming, which knocked stuff gravitationally out of their orbits, gave them little kicks. That's enough to send those objects in toward the sun. And so you can imagine a scenario where there's some Mars-sized object forming. One of the giant planets gives it that little gravitational kick, and it starts coming in toward the inner solar system, probably slowly, but eventually intersects the orbit of Earth and collides with proto-Earth.
Right, and so the point is that collisions seem to play a significant role, a somewhat significant role in the formation of the solar system, because Uranus is tilted on its side, and yes. Is there any way to get that tilt without a collision? I don't know of any.
I don't know.
Okay.
That is a question I actually don't
know. I just
know
remember learning
to.
In graduate school that was the explanation
that
we assumed.
That was for my graduate career as well,
okay,
the explanation
great.
For why Uranus would be on its side.
So at least we have evidence for two large collisions, and Venus going backwards, well, that could be collisions as well too.
Yeah.
Right. All right, in the back, in the blue, all the way in the very back, last row.
Oh,
that's you.
All right. We hear a lot about life on the moons. What about the moon collision, or the Mars-sized object that collided with the Earth? Is that a possibility for how life was brought to the Earth, because it either had water or it had some sort of chemical properties that this interaction with this object that created the moon also brought the properties that eventually evolved into life?
Okay, so could the collision have brought life to Earth or set up conditions that might have allowed life to develop on Earth?
This sort of collision almost definitely did not bring life to Earth. It would have been very violent, full of energy, very hot, and any sort of life most likely would have died in that sort of collision. Many of the life-bearing, the ingredients for life, like water, would probably have been lost because they have a low temperature at which they evaporate. I'm not saying that it probably was all lost, and not necessarily all of it though. But definitely, the proto or the newly formed Earth did not have oceans on it. Let's put it that way. Okay, and that's one of the problems we're still working through. Actually, is how water was delivered to Earth. So this sort of collision was too hot, too violent for it to seed any sort of life.
Okay, right here.
If the Earth's magnetic flips, will that have an impact on the moon's orbit?
No. So the question was, will the Earth's magnetic field, when it flips, because it does flip on a periodic basis, will that affect the moon at all? And the answer is no. But the moon and the magnetic field of Earth don't
interplay.
Earth's magnetic field flips, what, every 100,000 years, 200,000 years, something like that? So, I mean, we can see in the rock record lots of flips of the magnetic field, and the moon's been doing its orbit for billions of years.
Yeah.
Over there, you. Yeah. Yes, you.
Two things. I was wondering about whether it was the Earth's actual slowing of rotation that made the moon pull further away from it, or vice versa. Mm-hmm. Which one actually happens first? I mean, which causes which?
Okay, so the question is the rotation and the slowing of the orbit, the slowing of the rotation, does one cause the other, or how does it all work?
They are mutual. They are mutual. They happen at the same time.
Okay, and one other question. I don't know if, although nothing dramatic would actually happen in our lifetime, I was wondering if there would be some time change in our lifespan, like, I don't know, adding 31 days to absolutely every month, adding another month, something of that nature in our lifetime.
Paid each weekend.
So we had our. You said the question is how quickly is this happening? Is there going to be some in a human life scale time scale? What is the time change? And this gentleman over here asked for an extra day in each weekend.
Yeah, that'll be great.
That's a lot of pressure. Now I feel like I have to provide it. So the amount of time change is 1 second. Longer every day is 1 second longer every 60,000 years.
Oh, yeah, we got a while.
So it's not gonna be in your lifetime. I'm very sorry. But there's kind of a fun cocktail party fact in there, which is that for the dinosaurs, their day was about 18 minutes shorter than ours is right now.
They didn't have clocks, so.
But they had less time to do what they wanted to do, okay? So when a dinosaur said he's short on time, he really was.
What was the minimum wage?
All right, in the back, we're there.
At the time of the collision with the proto-Earth, I'm having trouble visualizing how after you blast a big hole in it, it forms into a sphere again. How solid and brittle was it, or was it almost molten, or what?
Okay, so the question was, he's having trouble visualizing this collision. Was the proto-Earth molten? Was it solid? How do you get things? I mean, you know, you're thinking of, when you think of a Mars-sized body and an Earth-sized body, you might smash it in pieces. How does this all look?
Yeah, it is. I agree. It's incredibly hard to wrap your head around that. I still have trouble, even though I've seen simulations of it being done. And you can always Google Moon giant impact and look at images or video, and you'll probably get one of these cool visualizations. It was too big for me to put on the computer, so that's why I didn't have it for you guys. Like I said, everything's really hot, so most everything is molten at that point. A lot of stuff does evaporate. It is hot enough for rock to evaporate into a gas. Wow. So that Mars-sized object is so heated that it ends up becoming very small fraction of it is liquid. Most of it is evaporated. The Earth like gets a chunk carved out of it. So imagine having a bullseye with three rings carved down to that first ring and having a scoop taken out of it, which then kind of like falls into orbit around this mass of stuff, as you know, because you're dealing with an impact that's like this, so where my fists are the two bodies, and it very quickly that second body ends up orbiting, and the debris orbiting that first object. Most of that is not solid. Only that very central part of proto Earth is still solid. Almost the rest of proto Earth is liquid magma, and then what's around it is like a vapor hot mess. So, I still have a hard time figuring it out. Seeing it in my head myself.
Okay, we get time for only one last question. I saw his hand first. Sorry. I know you guys, both of you have great questions always, but over here.
I know the Earth's spin axis precesses like at 30,000 years or so. Does the moon's orbital plane follow the equator as it's doing that precession?
All right, so Earth's spin axis precesses, all right? Does the moon's orbital plane also precess?
That is a question I do not know the answer to.
You have stumped the speaker! Yeah! Orbital dynamics is not her specialty, at least of our moon right now.
No, orbital dynamics is my specialty, and I just don't know the answer to that question. That is, you know, 'cause the moon itself is not something. The Earth-Moon system isn't what I'm an expert
at. Right, so. That's what I meant to imply. Yeah. The thing is, you know so much about the rings of Saturn.
I know everything, Frank.
Yes.
And how
oh, okay. Ah, all right. Well, all right, next month. June 3rd, we will have a speaker. It will be a fantastic speaker. I just don't know who. I can't confirm for you who it will be at that time. Duncan, are you here? Yes, Duncan is back there. Duncan will take you across the street for the Maryland Space Grant Observatory's observing session. Thank you all for coming. Let's give Bonnie one great big hand.